Welcome to my world.
Escargot, pâté, frisé, two green salads.
Okay, that is what, yeah.
Lamb chop, steak street.
Shouldn't you be doing something?
Two faux filet and a pepper steak. Come on, make the dessert. Chocolate tart, please.
As a cook, taste and smells are my memories, and now I'm in search of new ones. So I'm leaving New York City and hope to have a few epiphanies around the world, and I'm willing to go to some lengths to do that.
I'm looking for extremes of emotion and experience.
I'll try anything. I'll risk everything. I have nothing to lose. I picked Cambodia as a place to go because I knew nothing about it, and because it was the last place on Earth that I guess I really wanted to go. Maybe you've seen the killing fields. This is just about all I knew of Cambodia. And I guess the first thing that struck me was, gee, it looks just like the movie. Familiar, frightening, and a little intimidating. At first, it's a little depressing. And you really wonder what people see in it. But the country grows on you. The people are lovely, and the food is eye-opening and mind-expanding. Using aromatic herbs and spices, traditional Cambodian cuisine is both complex and accessible. Fat and meats are used sparingly, while vegetables, fruits, and fish are used liberally.
We're in beautiful downtown Phnom Penh, Cambodia. This is where madmen, missionaries, relief workers, journalists, and backpackers and Westerners come to behave badly. Going to buy some crunchy, tasty breakfast, maybe a little fruit, pick up a little picnic lunch, and then go discharge some heavy weaponry. First, a haircut.
Last night, I was at the appropriately named Heart of Darkness bar, and I was told by a local expatriate who'd been here for some time the four rules of survival in Cambodia. One, always wear a condom. Two, don't drink the water. Three, throw out your anti-malaria pills. Four, for God's sake, stay away from the durian fruit. Stay away from it. That's all I needed to hear.
Dick Chanko's back, and he's got a kicky new summer do. I'm ready. I can appear in public in Cambodia. Let's eat. Let's go eat some crunchy bugs and little birdies and have some fruit, maybe kill something.
All right, I'm on the hunt for the king of all Asian fruits, the elusive, terrifying, melon-like durian. A man you can get easily distracted in the market.
Yeah, I need, like, identification of this product before I put it in my mouth this early in the morning, I think. You know, even identification might not do it for me, actually. The colors are beautiful. All right, maybe for lunch. Maybe we'll pick it up for a picnic.
The food in this place is really challenging my intestinal fortitude. My culinary bravado is starting to shrivel.
And it's stuff here that's, you know, alarmingly bright, sort of unnatural colors and jelly-like. That I think I'm going to lay off of. It looks radioactive. I try not to eat food that exhibits color that does not exist in nature. And then, of course, there's some stuff I know what it is, but I don't think I'll be having any, like the chicken skin and giblets. I see something I'm curious about though, that I might cut for breakfast.
All right, here we go. Crickets.
Well, let me get one. Let's get five. Head first or tail first? Anyway.
Could use a beer with them.
Kind of a cross between like french fries and beef jerky.
All right, enough distractions. Back to the mission at hand. I want durian. Must have durian. Need durian. Have to get some durian. Where's the durian? I should be able to smell it. I know it's around here somewhere. Oh, yeah, baby, the terrifying durian.
Do they have to sell you a whole one, I'm guessing? We'll buy a knife, and we'll buy some stuff, and then we'll tear into this someplace. Okay, if you can pick me out a nice one, then you can just wrap it to go. I saw kitchen equipment over there. We're going to try to get us a nice meat axe to cut the durian with. I gather from my limited reading on this subject that one does not want to be in a close, confined area with a lot of people around when you hack into this thing.
This dirty diaper-smelling fruit can weigh up to 12 pounds. Now that's a load.
Okay, we got our cutlery. We need to assemble a little picnic for ourselves, including a single durian in this double-wrapped bag here. The elephants, upon smelling durian, might charge and choose to stomp on me. This costs $10 US, $8 US, which is a lot for a piece of fruit anywhere in the world. So people really like this. I mean, this is hugely popular all over Asia. But, you know, it's a love-hate thing, because it stinks to high heaven, but apparently it's, you know, absolutely wonderful and addictive. And, I mean, I've heard about it, you know, in the States, you know, people talking about it, you know, it's an experience that, you know, they keep coming back to. It's a message board online, people like, how do I score durian in the United States? How do I get durian to the United States? So this is it.
The inside of the durian has five compartments containing the edible custardy pulp.
This looks like a lobe of foie gras, isn't it? Scary looking, huh? Almost smoky. It's actually really good. This is really good. It stinks to high heaven. It doesn't taste like it smells. It's actually subtle, kind of fruity, but the smell is very much part of the experience. Rich as all hell. I mean, you need, like, bring your friends to this experience. If you have any friends left after you've transported it, they're not going to love you for that. Now, as I understand it, one buys one of these little swallows, cups it in one's hands, and then releases it with a wish. And presumably, in return for your kindness and act of mercy, you will be granted this wish. Here we go. I'm making a wish. I hope that the smell of durian leaves me soon.
I've been told about a rather, how shall I say, unique eating experience about 15 kilometers out of town. I'm a little apprehensive. It's on a military base. Okay, I guess I didn't need to call ahead for reservations.
What do you recommend?
Yeah, I think we're going to try the K-57.
Let's do two magazines. Start. So, I'm kind of hungry. I'm thinking, you know, maybe play a little with a handgun. And then we'll snack.
This is no ordinary eater. Sure, you can order drinks and snacks, but the specialty of the house is firearms and artillery.
Nothing like a cold Angkor and the smell of cordite in the morning. I don't have a lot of breakfast like this in New York. Maybe I should. Whew. Sure, our audiences have noticed the similarity between me and a young Sean Connery. That's what we're shooting now. Chosen gun of James Bond and Walter BPK.
A lot of things in my life that I've done that have felt really, really good have had at least an element of shame involved.
Thanks. Okay, that'll do me.
You know, even if you're talking about a really good, really big, really rich meal, you feel a little bit ashamed of yourself afterwards.
Why is it that shame and pleasure are such close partners?
So as I leave the shooting range, I'm feeling a little bit ashamed. Although I did have a rollicking good time. But I still reek of that durian.
You're awesome.
I've been traveling around Asia, eating alone, strangers gawking at me and chattering in strange languages, eating every variety of strange food. It's lonely. So I'm very grateful and very happy that my friend and boss, Philippe, the owner of Layal, my restaurant in New York, decided to join me in Cambodia. I hear there's some organ meat in the market that Philippe would go crazy for. The French love organ meat.
We should point out that this market's like 130 degrees. I have to walk in a crouching position. There's, you know, under a tent, which, you know, ensures that all that nice heat and sort of the gas from the decomposing carcasses all around is rising up around you. This is all appetizing. So we're in for a treat.
Now, it's always good to rely on a Frenchman. Philippe's an adventurer and a colonialist in the best sense of the word. I love Philippe, and I love food, and it's really fun to travel with him. But you know, as with all things French, it's a love-hate thing, too. Philippe tends to get me in trouble. He wants to eat everything.
But there is a fish here that has been
basically
cut out
opened
open.
Up, butterflied, the major part of the rib removed, and the rest, like, I guess, hung in the smoke.
It's appetizing.
One of the insect district.
That's a beetle or that's a little bird?
That's a little bird.
We want a... You want the small one?
Yeah, let's have some crunchy little birds.
Fried chicken Cambodian style.
Roll it in a little of this stuff.
Salt and pepper and enjoy. And lime. Eat everything, right?
Oh, good.
It's delicious. I'm so happy. This is so good.
Take a bag of those for Nick's game. See here.
This is what I was talking about.
My last LSD trip looked just like this, by the way.
From what I can tell, this gelatinous substance is a real favorite for breakfast.
Oh, man, I'm going to have to taste this.
But I think I'm going to let Philippe go first.
This one here, a little bit. Not much. It's a bit, very jello-like, very bland. It's almost like a negative taste, you know, it's mm-hmm. less than taste.
Okay, that sounds right up my alley. It tastes like tea. It's like jelly green tea.
Well, excellent. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. We're headed to the tripe section. Philippe saw some really nasty bits of pig guts that, he's French.
Well,
need I say more?
I'll take this as a compliment. So this is mixed tripe, I guess, right? Okay, like this? Yes?
Big buckets of steaming, nasty-looking tripe. I make tripe very well, in the classic French manner. But I don't particularly like it. I think it smells like wet dog. So this particular tripe, I don't even know what animal it's from, and it's in a big nasty smelling heap with tongues mixed in there somewhere. Well, this is caviar to Philippe. He's got to have this.
Lemongrass tripe. Oh, yes. Yeah. See?
I'm convinced that he's poisoning me at this moment. I'm wondering why he hates me, why he's doing this to me.
Exactly what it is.
But you know the French, they're a mystery.
Remember, they like Jerry Lewis over there, too.
I'm thinking, run away, run away. And Philippe is like, eat more tripe, eat more bugs. Let's try that.
Mmm.
I'm like, get me back to the hotel. I want a grilled cheese sandwich. I finally drag Philippe away from the claustrophobia of the market and the organ beats. I'm in need of some open space. Having digested the culinary delights of the market, I'm ready to find the floating village on Lake Tonle Sap that I'd heard about.
What are they fussed about? Going out to a floating village. As I understand it, it's a fishing village. It's a reasonably self-contained community. As far as what to expect, once again, we'll know until we get there. But it's apparently an entire floating community.
I mean by that their houses float. Their livestock pens float. They operate floating fish farms, floating restaurants, floating businesses. Their entire lives, their entire communities are waterborne and move from place to place as situation requires. Philippe, once again, decides that he's going to risk life and limb, my life and limb, for emotional reasons and for an adventure. He's not content to eat in a restaurant. He wants to eat local food. And he sees a woman cooking food for her family.
You know, it'll rise with whatever she's preparing, you know, it'll fish concoction or...
And says, oh, let's eat what she's eating. I think she's very surprised to have us come along. And we're very aware of the fact that she very likely has little food. So all we want is a little taste to see what she's doing.
So what is it? Pork, fish, garlic.
Garlic?
Fish paste.
Nice save, Philippe. Outstanding. Chose the right place, Philippe. I think they're selling ballpark franks over there at the other place.
And all she's doing is stir-frying a mixture of pork and fish, served with rice and a little green onion.
But it smells so good.
Sugar?
Sugar.
Seems like sugar syrup.
Right, like a pure sugarcane syrup.
Pay attention, though, to how hot that wok is, how controlled the heat is, how well she manipulates the flame and the pot and the wood to apply heat to cook this very simple but very nutritious meal. This woman is very kind and very generous, and I think curious and maybe a little awed at the strange freakazoids who want to have a little taste of her food.
Oh, look at this. My God, thank you so much. I couldn't. Look at this.
You first, you sniff this meal out.
Ah, a little pepper. Oh, yeah. Right. Let me roast it a little first. Yes, like this? Yes? Okay. Mmm, smells delicious. I'll be back here.
Oh, it is good. Yes.
It's simple, it's honest, and it tastes good.
Fresh water done.
It's the people that make the difference. And if you're going to travel, it's always wonderful to eat what the people are eating at your destination. This is the way they feed themselves. This is the way they live. This is what they're eating. This is not hotel food. I am aware, however, as I'm eating it, she's washing the pot in the river water. But I should probably visit my gastroenterologist when I return to New York. You know, I'm reconsidering traveling with this guy.
That does me.
Very good. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Here comes dessert.
Yeah, it is.
It's like bananas flambé. I mean, it's basically
all desserts.
Looks sweet to me.
There's a little floating dessert boat that pops up alongside. I guess they see us from a little downriver and come sailing up with some caramelized bananas and fresh fruit and sweets.
So it's only fruits, right?
It smells so good.
That is a mango.
Mango. Pickled mango.
Okay.
So we start with this here?
Yeah.
Mmm, that's great. Spectacular. Just look.
So if you're really curious about a country, eat how everyday people eat. And this is how everyday people eat in this village. Sometimes you find satisfying meals in the strangest places.
It's good. I just violated absolutely every Lonely Planet traveler's guide there is and loved it.
Let's see, unripened fruit, fecal coliform bacteria.
And that's why I love Philippe, and why I hate Philippe. He's so happy.
Oh, sole mio.
He inspires both the best and the worst in me. So this was something I'm glad I didn't miss.
Hookworm and liver fluke, add that to the Lonely Planet violations today.
Philippe and I have traveled from Phnom Penh to Siem Reap to explore the last vestiges of a once mighty empire and to discover high-end Khmer cuisine.
And Khmer what? Looking good. Don't see this in Jersey.
Truly one of the most imposing sights of the ancient world, a city of temples in the middle of the jungle.
You can't even take pictures of this. It's too big. It's just too beautiful. It's too intricate. It's endless.
Yeah, there's a nice view here. On one of the seven wonders of the world.
It's the child's dream of adventure. There you are, standing next to evidence of a magnificent and intricate ancient civilization. You're dwarfed by the scale and the volume of it all. This was the pinnacle of the Khmer Empire. And I'm ready for a meal that matches the grandeur of this experience, or at least comes close. Home to the famed Angkor Wat temples, the city of Siem Reap has a world-class hotel that caters to foreign tourists. This is Philippe's last night in Asia. He's got to get back to Laayao. So as an appropriate send-off, we decide to have, in the hotel, a royal Cambodian meal.
After a morning spent eating tripes and tongues and bugs and a rather run-down and, you know, not-so-tidy Phnom Penh, and an afternoon spent firing automatic weapons outside of town, decided that we deserve to live like colonial imperialist pig dogs.
So we tuck into some really excellent, very well-prepared, very subtle, very precise, colorful food that really, for the first time, gives us a sense of the possibilities inherent in traditional Khmer cuisine.
We have a first course here.
Beef, crushed peanuts, black mushrooms, and minced sweet basil in a fresh rice paper wrapping.
Again, really fresh.
Sure, it's an egg roll, but it's a damn good one. Pumpkin and lemongrass soup with a dollop of coconut milk.
This is lovely. Thank you. Pumpkin, cool.
And a nice touch, a cumin stirring stick that infuses flavor.
Delicious.
Beef sautéed with garlic, red peppers, and soy sauce. Served in a banana leaf.
This one is your beef roll.
And garnished with deep-fried threads of ginger, turmeric, potato, and taro.
That's extraordinary.
Is it one steamed fish and one steamed rice level?
Whole grouper, steamed with shiitake mushrooms. Topped with red pepper, cilantro, scallions, and fresh ginger. And finished with hot oil and a chili sauce. A really good meal, beautifully presented. A truly inventive use of local ingredients, creating rich and textured dishes.
Really well. Stick with this idea.
I'll miss Philippe, but I'm recharged and ready to move on for more food adventures.